You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Gerald Turney and I'm your host and instructor. And this is the gardening show where we talk about everything from apples to zinnias and trees to turf. So we are live and you can call in with your questions about your garden. Anything you want to talk about, you want to call in about fruit trees or your lawn, how to water, how to fertilize, whatever it is. Our number is 800-339-1193. Give us a call and let us know what's happening in your garden, or if you have a problem with your garden, let me know and I can probably answer it, but maybe not. I can probably direct you to where you can get the answer. If you haven't watched the show before, I'm a plant pathologist. I diagnose plant diseases or problems to plants. My Bachelor of Science is in botany and my PhD is in plant pathology, and I'm a certified arborist and an agricultural pest control advisor. I have a long history in technical maintenance of landscapes and how to control pests in farms and things like that. So give us a call, I can probably answer your question. Now, we always start our show with upcoming events. If you're a student in the class, you need to attend one outside event and write an essay about it and tell me what you learned at that event. So let's look at some of our upcoming events. Creating a spring edible garden at the South Coast Botanic Garden is held every Friday in February from 10 to 11:30. Give them a call, 310-544-1948 for any additional information. How to grow and hybridize euphorbia at the South Coast Botanical Garden will be Sunday, February 10th at 1:30. And if you're interested in succulents and especially African succulents, euphorbia is an African group of succulents. In addition to that, we have Learn to Start Your Home Vegetable Garden at the Natural History Museum on Monday, February 11th at 1 o'clock. So it is time to start planting your summer vegetables. You can plant on March 15th, which is coming up. So you want to start preparing for that if you're interested in that. In addition to that, let's see, we have a garden talk and sale, Magnolias for the Home Garden at the Huntington Library and Botanic Gardens on Thursday, February 14th at 2:30. Magnolias are a great group of trees. There's deciduous magnolias and evergreen magnolias, and they're wonderful trees for Southern California. Let's see if we have any additional upcoming events. How many are we going to cover? A bonsai workshop at the Huntington Library and Botanic Gardens will be Saturday, February 23rd from 9 to noon. This will be a really wonderful class on how to prune in a broad sense, but specifically how to create your bonsais. Bonsai is the ultimate form of pruning, and you can make little tiny plants look very old. Let's see if we have any additional upcoming events. Yes, the Great Garden Plants at Admiration and Arboretum Exploration with Lily Singer will be at the Los Angeles County Arboretum on February 28th. Lily has a Thursday garden series at the Arboretum, and if you can attend, it's an excellent series of talks on all sorts of aspects and issues related to gardening and taking care of your landscape, vegetable gardening, fruit trees, everything you can think of. Lily has an extensive experience also in natives, so if you're interested in growing natives, that would be a wonderful event or series of lectures to attend and hook up and talk to Lily Singer about growing natives. Now today we're going to talk about fungi and the role of fungi in the garden and in landscapes and in farms and in our natural environment. But before we do that, I like to have a mystery plant or a mystery fruit. We had last week, and again this week we're going to have a mystery fruit. So let's take a quick look at that. Here it is. Now, I think this one someone will get pretty quick. We had a caller call in last week who guessed the cherimoya and the sourpaw. Now, these are not that unusual. They're not marketed typically because of they're so large. And the people who market this type of fruit don't like huge fruits maybe there's not that big a market for them, but they're very popular in the Asian community. And so I had an opportunity to get a couple this week, and here they are. If you recognize these, give us a call and tell us what they are. It's actually a very important species in a lot of ways, even though they're not really sold in supermarkets so much. Give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. And we'll talk about this particular fruit tree and where you could actually get some if you want to buy it and grow some in your own garden, because they do quite well in Southern California. I'm just going to leave them sitting here so you don't forget to call us and take a guess. A lot of times I like to bring in a pest that's come into my laboratory. I am a senior biologist, plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner. And I run a plant diagnostic clinic or laboratory where I identify various pests of plants. We also have an entomologist who does all the insects and mollusks, slugs, snails, things like that, and all the different insects. I do plant pathogens and nematodes and weeds. But this is actually an insect pest. If we can go to the overhead camera and maybe zoom in a little bit. A few years back, we had a new pest introduced on citrus, and it's called the citrus leaf miner. And let's take a look at this. And you can see here what is really a rather serpentine pattern here in the leaf. And maybe there's another one that shows it well, too. Here, this is the backside of the leaf, but it can appear on either side, top or bottom. And it causes the leaves to be twisted and contorted. And a lot of people call up and think they have citrus greening, and that's not likely since only one tree has been found infected with citrus greening in California, and that was back in the spring. You don't see it so clearly here, but this is actually a moth, and the larva or the caterpillar feeds inside the leaf. So the moths are quite small, really, really teeny, and nocturnal, so you're not going to see them. And they lay their eggs on the leaves, and then the eggs hatch, and the caterpillar comes out and burrows into the leaf, and then eats inside the leaf and leaves this rather meandering trail, and then pupates and flies off as an adult moth. And this has become widespread now, and is very common. Luckily, it's fairly easy to control. It was on this branch that came into the lab, right here. And you can see that most of this branch was infested. Most of the leaves had been infested with the citrus leaf miner. Now, there is a peel miner as well. It's a different species moth, very closely related to the leaf miner. And the peel miner is very rare. You almost never see the peel miner. But if you look right here, you can see all these leaves in here are infested, and they're all twisted and curled. Now, on a mature tree, it's not that big a deal because the leaves are still photosynthetic, and it doesn't hurt the tree all that much. It makes it look bad, and most of us don't want our trees to look bad. So it's fairly easy to control. There's two ways to control it. The easiest way, from my perspective, is the citrus leaf miner trap. It's a white triangular trap with a sticky board and a pheromone attractant, which attracts all the male moths. The female moths give off a sex pheromone, a chemical that attracts the males, and the males can follow that at great distance. I'm not sure specifically in this species, but it's not uncommon for insects to be able to detect a pheromone from a mile away, and then follow that pheromone directly to the female in order to mate. So insects need a way to find themselves out in the environment, males and females, in order to mate and then have viable eggs. So if you put out the trap in late June and then replace it at the end of July and replace it at the end of September, so you have a trap out for July, August, September for 3 months, you'll get nearly complete control of the citrus leaf miner. It's a little sticky board, and it has a little packet, and you cut the packet open, and it's got a little piece of foam with the pheromone on it, and you shake that down onto the sticky board. You don't want to handle that and then handle the outside of the trap, because then you get the pheromone on the outside of the trap, and all the male moths will be on the outside. So once you put that pheromone impregnated foam, on the sticky board and slide it into the trap, it says to hang it in the tree. It actually works better if you'll hang it on a fence away from the tree. It will attract all the male moths to the trap, and then the females won't be able to mate and lay eggs, or lay viable eggs. And it's very effective. You do need to have one out each month, July, August, September. And now it's too cold in the spring for the moths to be active, and so you won't see your first moths, if you were trapping, you won't really trap any moths until the end of June at the earliest. So if you put out a trap at the end of June and then have a trap out for those 3 months, you'll get nearly 100% control of citrus leaf miner, and it very well may control it for your whole block. Now, it wouldn't hurt to have several traps across many homes, but one trap on a fence away from the tree is very effective. The Orange County Master Gardener Program researched this and experimented with it for several years and found it works better when you hang it on a fence rather than hang it right in the tree, even though it says on the trap to hang it in the tree. So that's the pest of the day, the citrus leaf miner. Very, very common now and widespread throughout Southern California. So what I forgot to show you last week, our first show of the new semester, is our textbook. The textbook is the Western Garden book from Sunset. This is really an encyclopedia of plants, plus a lot of other very good information. This is a wonderful book, really the very first book that you should get if you're interested in gardening and you want to buy a book on gardening. There's an encyclopedia of plants. It's very extensive. And then at the end of the book, there's a lot of sections on fertilizing, pruning, pest control. And in the beginning of the book, there's a section on all the different zones, the 24 zones of the Western United States. You know, 24 is right along the coast, and then certain plants do well in certain areas. And then when you read about the plant in the encyclopedia part, it'll say it's appropriate for zones 18 through 24, or it's appropriate for this area, and so you can refer back to that beginning. Also, in the beginning, there's a section on plant uses, plants good for around pools, plants good for rock gardens, plants good for attracting butterflies or hummingbirds. And the last section is plants that are resistant to oak root rot fungus or Armillaria mellia, and we'll talk a little bit about that fungus today later on. But that's a very nice section talking about plant uses, you know, where you can use plants for their best effect, and, you know, plants for screening, plants for color, plants for rock gardens, things like that. So it's a wonderful book. I refer to it quite frequently myself to read about a lot of plants that maybe I don't have a lot of experience with, because you can't know them all. There's hundreds of thousands of plants out there and you can't know them all. Now, they're not all in that book either. These are really landscape materials, but there's a good section on tomatoes and fruit trees and everything. So, and of course, if you have a question that you can't answer in the Sunset Western Garden book, call me and maybe I can answer it. So let's talk about mushrooms and fungi. When I got my PhD in plant pathology, I had to specialize in one group of pathogens, and I specialized in fungi. Others specialized in viral pathogens of plants or in bacterial pathogens of plants. And of course, you had to work on one pathogen to do your research and write your thesis, but you had to know the whole group. So really, I'm kind of a mycologist as much as I am a botanist. And the fun part of mycology is mushroom hunting, collecting mushrooms, recognizing the various kinds of fungi out there. But fungi play a very important role in landscapes and gardens and the natural environment. They can either be pathogens, infecting plants and causing disease, like powdery mildew on roses or rust on roses, or powdery mildew on many different plants and also rust on many different plants, or they can be just saprophytes that decompose plant material, like, you know, old decaying leaves and that fall in the ground, and then they rot the leaves and they recycle the materials in the leaves, the nitrogen and everything. They use the cellulose and other carbohydrates as a food source, and of course they're going to use the nitrogen too, but they recycle all this organic matter in the soil. They're not the only recyclers, but they are a significant part of the recycling of organic matter in the soil. So they can be pathogens, or they can be saprophytes, or they can actually be beneficial symbionts, or mutualists, where they both benefit. And those are what we call mycorrhizae, or one group of those is mycorrhizae. I can't actually, off the top of my head, think of any other fungi that would be symbiotic with plants and mutualistic in that they're good for the plant. So mycorrhizae are fungi that infect the roots of plants and grow out into the soil and absorb nutrients and water. And then they provide that to the plant or the tree. And in return, the plant provides them with the sugars they make in their leaves. And so both benefit. Some plants, and many, many plants actually, are highly dependent on their mycorrhizal symbionts. And if you grow them in the absence of the mycorrhizal symbiont, then they are nutrient deficient, particularly in very hard minerals to absorb. Roots are not all that great at absorbing some types of minerals, particularly zinc I'm trying to think of the other one, but zinc particularly, and the mycorrhizae are very good at it. And so citrus, if you grow that in a fumigated soil and you don't add in the mycorrhizae, they'll often be bright yellow. Grapes as well. Grapes need their mycorrhizal partners beyond the roots in order to get all the nutrients they need out of the soil. The reason the fungi, one of the reasons the fungi are so good at absorbing these various nutrients that are dissolved in the soil solution in very, very tiny amounts, because most of these things are highly insoluble. Iron, zinc, magnesium, manganese, all these other minerals that also absorb nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium as well, is because fungi grow by microscopic filaments or tubes. And they they're really tiny and they're like a tube and they grow out into the soil, but they ramify out into the soil and they have a huge surface area. So they're able to have a much greater surface area than roots do. There are two broad groups of mycorrhizae. There are what we call the ectomycorrhizae, or those that grow on the outside of the root. And then there are the endomycorrhizae, which grow inside the root. Most plants actually form endomycorrhizal associations, like fruit trees and vegetables and grasses and many, many shrubs. And the vast majority of plants are actually endomycorrhizal. About 10% of the plants on Earth are ectomycorrhizal, and those are mostly temperate tree species. Oaks, the Fabaceae, the oaks, maples, all the pines, eucalyptus can be both actually, endo and ectomycorrhizal. But most of the trees we see in North America, in Europe, those are gonna be ectomycorrhizal. Not all trees. Fruit trees, for the most part, are endomycorrhizal, like citrus and the stone fruits, peaches, nectarines, things like that. Now, mycorrhizae are common and ubiquitous in soils. They're typically there, they're not gone, unless you did something to get rid of them. So how do you get rid of them? You fumigate the soil. That's a great way to get rid of them. The other thing is to grade them off. If you're preparing an area to build a home and you grade it and you scrape off the top 3 feet, you've pretty much eliminated all the mycorrhizae. In agricultural production, it's not unusual to come in and fumigate fields prior to planting, especially if you're planting fruit trees and you know you had a problem in that field with a fungal pathogen or some type of pathogen, maybe nematodes, and you want to knock them down and eliminate them to the best of your ability before you plant. Well, then you're going to have to come back and reintroduce the mycorrhizae. You can do that in nursery production before you plant them out, or you can add it in to each hole when you plant each tree. So now mycorrhizae are being sold. You can buy them as just pure inoculants, or you can buy them mixed with fertilizers. So a lot of people are selling them that way. Dr. Earth is one such product. It's a fertilizer with a mixture of different species of mycorrhizae. And so typically when you buy these inoculants, these mycorrhizal inoculants, it's a mixture. It's not just one species. If you look at it, you'll see that there's a handful of different fungi listed on the label. And they'll be ectomycorrhizal fungi and they'll be endomycorrhizal fungi. The idea being that you can put it on any plant. You could use it in your vegetable garden and it would infect your tomatoes and peppers and squash and all that kind of stuff. Or you could put it in a hole planting an oak tree and the ectomycorrhizal fungi would infect the oak tree. It's not really necessary to add it into a soil that that hasn't been disturbed or where they haven't been eliminated. It can't hurt. In fact, you could probably get better growth, a little better growth, if you are inoculating them in advance and getting it going really early. And I typically have a bag of fertilizer with mycorrhizae in it. When I plant plants, I sprinkle a little in each hole just to make sure I'm giving them a good start. So I always do that for my vegetable garden. I do it for my tomatoes and peppers and all that kind of stuff. And I do it in pots too. And here's another good point is in, that's a good place to use mycorrhizae is if you're buying bagged potting soil and you're growing a lot of plants in pots, it's a good idea to add mycorrhizae into the pot. It may or may not be in your potting soils. There are some potting soils now that include mycorrhizae, and so you wouldn't have to add it to that. But if you buy typical potting soils, they will not have mycorrhizae spores mixed in with it. So those are the roles, the three roles that fungi play in the garden: pathogens, recycling saprophytes, you know, growing and decomposing organic matter, and then beneficial mycorrhizae. So those are the three roles that really fungi play. They can do a handful of other little things too, but that's the majority of what we're talking about. Let's take a look at another book, a couple books. First, let's look at this book here. This is Mushrooms Demystified by David Arora. This is a key, and this is to be differentiated with the Western Garden book. The Western Garden book is an encyclopedia. It's not a key. A key allows you to identify something you find, a plant, an insect, whatever you find, and you go get a key, and then you observe the characteristics of the organism you're looking at, and then work the key. And typically a key always gives you two questions. In this case, with fungi, it'll say fruiting body, because that's what we call mushrooms, or all these different types of reproductive structures from fungi. It's fruiting body with gills, a fruiting body without gills. So if it's got gills, you look over to the side of the page and it says go to page 2. And it says, you know, if your fruiting body doesn't have gills, then you look over and it says go to page 5. And then it'll give you more questions like that. You work your way through the key until you get to the name of the species. That can be difficult to do if you don't have a lot of experience with it, but it's not that hard to learn. And the more you use it, the easier it gets. So this is Mushrooms Demystified by David Arora. He actually lives in the Santa Cruz area, I believe. And this is excellent for California. Maybe not so great for the eastern United States, but really excellent for California. And one of the best keys you can get for if you want to go mushrooming and identify the mushrooms you find in the woods. Now, if you become a little more intense about it and you have a microscope, because that book is not intended to be used with a microscope. The idea of this book is it's a field guide in that you can go out and just look at the field characteristics that you can see and then identify your mushrooms. Maybe you're not going to identify all of them because a lot of them you're going to need a microscope. Now, if you are like me, you have this set also and a bunch of other books as well. This is the Agaricales of California. The Agaricales are the gilled mushrooms. You know, all these different mushrooms you find growing in your lawn, growing at the base of a tree, wherever you would find these various mushrooms growing, these two books, and there's a third book as well, will pretty much cover almost everything you find. But you need a microscope, you need some experience in looking at it and knowing how to interpret the terminology. They're not the easiest books in the world to use. It takes some experience. These are fairly expensive. Mushrooms Demystified, I think, runs around $35, maybe $40. The Agaricales of California was more like $450. So Agaricales of California is not for everyone, but I have a laboratory and I identify mushrooms, so I needed it. I've got a whole bunch of other books as well, because often if you get something that's within a genus and you can't find it in this book, and then you go to a book that's specific for that genus, and then you start using that book. Now, the first thing you do when you are identifying a mushroom is you collect it, of course. Now, when you collect a mushroom and it's growing on the ground, you need to get the whole mushroom. So you need a trowel or you need something to stick in the ground and pop it up and get the whole mushroom. If you just grab it and pull on it and the stem breaks and you leave the base in the soil, you're going to lose an important part of the mushroom that's going to be in the key. And that's because some mushrooms have what we call a vulva or a sac at the base, and it can be buried in the soil, maybe an inch or two down. So you need to be able to get the whole thing. A trowel is perfect for that. And then you want to take any notes you can or observe everything you can about the mushroom you collect, where it's growing, what it's growing in or on, the season it's growing, anything you can see, you know, the color of the cap, the size, how the gills look, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. Once you collect your mushroom, usually the first couplet in all the keys is what we call the color of the spore print. Now, how do you make a spore print? I picked up a couple mushrooms at the supermarket the other day, and this is a typical gilled mushroom. This is Agaricus bisporus. And what you do is you break the mushroom off of the stem. You break the stem off. Here, let's take a look at the here. Here's one where the stem is still here, but it's too tall. If I set it, it's going to be like, it'll be too big. It'll tilt. I don't want it to tilt. I want it to sit flat. So you sit it flat, and then you cover it with a bowl to stop the air, so there's no air movement. And then you let it sit like this for about an hour. If it's you know, right at the right time in the life of the mushroom, it's releasing spores off the gills, and the spores shoot off and float down and land on the paper, and they make a pattern. Now, I doubt if I've got anything from this one yet, and I probably won't get it, because I actually had it in a plastic bag, which, you know, if you never put mushrooms in a plastic bag if you want to spore print them, because they won't print after that. But that's how you do it. And this little sheet I made up, so you can make a drawing, and you can make a spore print, and you can take notes, and then you can come back to the key, especially if you're collecting a lot of mushrooms. But this particular mushroom is the button mushroom, and these are sold as portobellos, but it's the same species as the little white button mushrooms. It's Agaricus bisporus, the most commonly sold mushroom in the United States and in many parts of the world, Europe, not so much in Asia. But if you make a spore print, let me show you what a spore print looks like, because I've got a bunch of them from other mushrooms I've collected over the years. And this is what a spore print looks like. And let's go to the overhead on that. And it looks, you know, a lot like the gills, kind of like a mirror image of the gills. And there it is. Now you can see all these lines. And this is spores, and this is kind of a light brown. The spore color can be anywhere from white to off-white, pink, lavender, brown, dark brown, chocolate brown, black, green, yellow, almost any color you can think of. And that can be a little confusing because everyone kind of can see colors differently, but that's a spore print. And here's one that's a little slightly different color. Most of the spores have been rubbed off on this one. I identified that one. But anyway, so that's a spore print. The first thing you do to identify a mushroom is make a spore print. I guess you could say the first thing you do is collect it, but really, from a perspective of working the key, the first thing you need to do is make the spore print so you know the color of the spores in mass. When you look at them in a microscope on a slide, they'll be clear, that you won't see the color. So I want to talk to you about that. Now, what are the parts of the mushroom that are important if you're going to go out? And the reason I'm kind of talking about this light, because it's been raining, and in Southern California, we get our mushrooms in the winter. So once it rains, you can go out and collect mushrooms. So what are the parts of the mushroom that we can talk about? Okay, this is a typical mushroom. Like I said, this is Agaricus bisporus, the one they sell in the supermarkets. These are the gills right in here. And in the Agaricus, in the genus Agaricus, they're chocolate brown. They're dark brown to black. This is the stem or the stipe. And here's the one I broke out of the other one. And this is called the partial veil. If it's still attached, see, there's two kinds of veils. And here it is here. And when it breaks off and it's stuck to the stipe or the stem, then it's called an annulus or a ring. So this is the ring. Not all mushrooms have an annulus or a ring, and not all mushrooms have the universal veil, which turns into the vulva. So being there or not being there, and what it looks like. Is it a little tiny wispy thing, or is it a long and skirt-like? And it can be in between too. So all those things are very important when you're trying to identify a mushroom. Let's talk about some of the more common mushrooms you're going to see. Let's bring this up full screen. This is the oak root rot fungus here on the screen now. And you can see here are the gills. This is the gill surface where the spores are made. And here's the annulus or ring. And in this case, the gills are coming down the stem. How the gills attach to the stem is an important characteristic. They can be free, which means they don't make it to the stem all the way, or they can be attached to the stem, or they can actually run down the stem a little. That's called decurrent. So if they're running down the stem, it's called decurrent. And I just managed to spill some water, but I'll mop it up. So anyway, this is the oak root rot mushroom or fungus. It is a pathogen. It's common in any areas of Southern California that used to be an oak woodland. It's one of the more common causes of trees and shrubs dying in Southern California. It's really the first one I look for when I go out and look at a plant and it's in decline or it's died. It will fruit off of stumps for many years, and there's no way to get rid of it. It really is in the soil, and it can occupy many acres, not just one little corner of your yard. It's in my yard where I live and my mother's home next door. It's killed a bunch of the plants in my yard, and there's nothing I can do about it other than grow resistant plant materials. And there's a good list in the Sunset Western Garden book. So the mushrooms come up, Armillaria mellia, or oak root rot fungus, comes up or produces its mushrooms starting about mid-December to about mid-January. So if you see mushrooms in a lawn in July or August, that's not oak root rot fungus. It's the wrong time of year, and it's growing in the wrong spot. They form at the base of infected trees or right on the trunk of infected trees. And they also might make what we call a mycelial fan or a mycelial plaque underneath the bark. So if you pull the bark off and you find this white growth between the bark and the wood, that is diagnostic for oak root rot fungus. If you live in the San Gabriel Valley or you live in the Beverly Hills area or actually anywhere, but that's where I see it the most. I see it a lot in the San Gabriel Valley. That was an oak woodland. The reason we call it oak root rot fungus is because when people first, when Europeans first started coming into Southern California in the 1800s, and they cut down a lot of the oaks, and they planted grapes, or they planted citrus, or they planted other types of woody perennial crops, and wherever there was an oak, they would get infected with this fungus, this mushroom-forming fungus, a true fungus, and they referred to it as the oak root rot fungus because they associated it with oak trees. On the East Coast, it's called the shoestring fungus because one of the other diagnostic characteristics is what we call a rhizomorph, and that is this shoestring-like fungal tissue. It's black with a white tip, and it can wrap around roots, or it can grow out through the soil and hit other roots and start new infections. That's actually how it moves from tree to tree, underground by the rhizomorphs. The spores made in the mushrooms don't play really any role in disseminating the fungus. Now, armillaria is edible, but it's extremely foul-tasting when it's raw, so it has to be cooked, and you got to get it quick because a lot of flies and beetles will lay their eggs in it, and it'll be filled with all sorts of insects rather quickly. So usually you got to get it before they fully expand, or it'll be filled with all sorts of insect larvae, beetles, flies, all sorts of stuff. And there's a lot of insects that are associated with the fruiting bodies of fungi. So that's Armillaria mellia. This is probably one of the more common fungi you'll see fruiting around Southern California, especially in December and January. Now, if we look at the next picture, we can see one of the more famous fungi. This is Amanita phalloides. And Amanita, the genus Amanita, is white-spored. And I forgot to mention that the armillarias are also white-spored, but it's a creamy white. It's not a pure white. The Amanitas are a pure white. So if you, let's bring this up full screen. I want to talk about a few things. The Amanitas are deadly. Most of them, or many of them, are deadly poisonous. So they're referred to as death angels or death caps. All it takes is a little bit, and they've got a liver toxin that destroys your liver, and then you don't have much chance of living. But this here, this structure right in here, is called the vulva. And what it was when this was just starting to come up, this part here enveloped the entire mushroom, and it was the universal veil. Then the mushroom pops up through the universal veil and leaves this remnant behind, and that's the vulva. So if you just grab this and break and pull on it, you might leave this behind. That's why it's important to collect the entire mushroom, all the parts of the mushroom, even any parts that may be underground. If you miss this, you're going to misidentify the mushroom. So this is Amanita phalloides. And if we look at the next picture, which is Amanita ocreata, and all of these are deadly poisonous that I'm showing you so far, not the armillaria. Here is the universal veil. And you can see this one is just pushing up through, and here's the, they look like eggs. You know, they look like an egg, just like this. And then the mushroom pushes up through, and for those mushrooms that have a universal veil. Now, not all mushrooms have a universal veil, and not all mushrooms have an annulus or a ring, which is the partial veil. The partial veil goes from the edge of the mushroom to the stem and covers the gills. Universal veil covers the entire mushroom. So if we look at our next picture, this is Omphalotus olivescens. This is the jack-o'-lantern mushroom. It's supposed to glow or be bioluminescent. And you can see this one is growing right off the wood, right here. This is a tree, an oak tree. And the gills run down the stem, so it's decurrent, but there's no annulus or ring, and there's no universal veil. This is a pathogen. And it causes a root rot and a decay on trees. I've only seen it in the wild a few times. At Descanso Gardens in La Cañada, I saw it on some oak stumps. I've also seen it out at Rancho Santa Ana in Claremont on an oak. And when I came back years later, that oak was gone because it had died. So it's a pretty aggressive pathogen. It'll kill trees, not quickly. It takes many years for R. malaria or Omphalotus to kill trees. So it's important when you're collecting mushrooms to note what it's growing on. In this case, it's growing directly on the wood. And that'll almost certainly be part of the key. Now, if we take a look at our next picture, this is Amanita muscaria. And this is the mushroom of fairy tales and children's books. It is an Amanita. And all these little white patches, all this little white stuff all over the top is the remnants of the universal veil. And the vulva is actually kind of, it's not so sac-like on Amanita muscaria. It's more ridge-like. And you see this one's just starting to come up and break up that universal veil. Now, if it rains a whole lot, this can all wash off and it can be red. There's also a yellow variant of this, but this is Amanita muscaria, and it's called the fly agaric as well. It is poisonous, although really more hallucinogenic than it is deadly poisonous. Not all Amanitas are poisonous, and some people will tell you never eat a mushroom with a vulva. Well, that's not the worst advice. It's not necessary to be that strict about it, but if you never eat a mushroom with a vulva, you're not likely to eat any Amanitas. There are some very easy mushrooms to identify that are very good edibles. And our next one, number six, let's take a look at this. This is Lepista nuda. And Lepista nuda is called the bluet or the blue hat. And it is a violet mushroom. Now, the gills in this case stop before they get to the, you see, they don't go all the way. They kind of come down. They may be adnexed, but there is no ring. There's no ring. There's no vulva. See, that's why, and you see those dirt? You see that? You pop this up. This grows usually in the duff under oaks. This one's a little washed out by the rain. Sometimes there are, when they first come up, they can be a very dark lavender, almost purple. And so it's one of the easiest mushrooms to identify. The color is really pretty unique. And the absence of the ring and the absence of the vulva and the color, and the gills don't make it all the way, and it grows in the duff. You see all these oak leaves? It's growing underneath an oak. This is actually a very easy mushroom to identify. And as you go out and collect mushrooms, if you're into mushrooming, then you can get used to a lot of these various mushrooms, and or get to the point that you recognize them just the way you might recognize an orange versus an apple or a peach. It's not that difficult. But you don't want to go out and collect a mushroom you don't know anything about, that you can't identify, and then go ahead and eat it, because that's a good way to get sick. And there's two ways to get sick. There are, with the Amanitas, we looked at a couple of the Amanitas, they have a liver toxin, and it shuts down your liver. And then within a very short period of time, maybe a week, you'll die. Or you'll need a liver transplant, and you're not likely to get that real quick. The other kind of poisoning is gastrointestinal poisoning, which means you get sick to your stomach, and you may throw up, and you may have some other unpleasant symptoms, but you won't die. And in fact, the most common of all the mushroom poisonings is gastrointestinal poisoning, because the most common is the green parasol mushroom. And I may have some pictures of that later on. I guess I don't have a picture of the green parasol. That comes up in the summer, and the gills are green. It is the only green spored mushroom in North America, probably the world. And it's called the green parasol. When it first comes up and opens up, the gills will be white. But very quickly, they'll turn a light green, and then as it ages, they'll get dark green. So if you cut off that cap and make a spore print, you're going to get a green spore print. If you get a green spore print, you know you've got the green parasol. And the Latin name is Chlorophyllum molybdides. And it's got warts all over the cap, or little broken pieces of the universal, I guess it's a universal veil. But it's got all this stuff all over the cap. And I should have a picture of it. I'm remiss not to have that as part of my photographs to show you. Now, let's take a look at our next mushroom, the oyster mushroom, number 7. Oyster mushroom is sold in supermarkets, very, very common. And it often has no stem. Let's bring it up full screen. This is fruiting off of a log. And some of these have a little bit of a stem. Others are what we call sessile. But the gills run down the stem. It's decurrent. There's no annulus. There's no ring anywhere. There's no ring. There's no vulva. It grows on wood. So that's another key characteristic. It can come up I see it quite often in the summer or in the spring, growing on fallen trees in the forest. I found it at the Huntington. But I see we have a caller. So let's go to our caller and see who we have on for call. Terry, calling from South Pasadena. You're on the air.
Hi, I have a question.
Okay.
My friend gave me a moth orchard, and I wanted to know how to take care of it, and can I grow it outside?
So your friend gave you a moth orchid?
Orchid.
Okay. Well, the moth orchid, the actual genus is Phalaenopsis. And it's probably one of the more common orchids now. You can see them in all the supermarkets and everywhere. They sell them everywhere. And they're fairly inexpensive, and they can bloom for months. They are very sensitive to full sun, especially on a hot day. So they're best if you're in an eastern or a northern window. Now, during the winter, you can't grow them outdoors because they cannot tolerate really cold temperatures at all. So starting sometime in the spring, probably in March, you could put it outdoors. And it can get a little bit of morning sun, but not much past 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock at the latest. And in the summer, I might really limit that to not past 10. It's normally grown under shade cloth or in greenhouses. They need to be repotted about once a year or once every 2 years, depending on how quickly they grow. And they'll repeat bloom for you as long as you don't kill them. And the good way to kill them is to leave them outside all winter. The cold temperatures we had a few weeks ago would have just killed it for sure. And then after it blooms, you can cut the old bloom spike off and then fertilize it once or twice a month. You can water it about once a week. In the hottest part of the summer, you might water it twice a week. When you repot it, I would repot it in a coarse orchid bark, coarse or medium orchid bark. You can probably get an orchid bark mix at a nursery, and it may include a little perlite and some charcoal and things like that, but you don't want to use a cymbidium mix because that's too heavy. Cymbidiums are terrestrial orchids, and Phalaenopsis are orchids that grow in trees in their natural habitat. So a bright shade or a dappled sun, no afternoon sun at all, especially in the summer months. They'll burn very easily. So they're very sensitive to this full sun in the heat. They're very sensitive to cold, and they only need to be watered about once a week. Okay?
Thanks a lot. Thank you for all that information.
Okay.
On your show.
And they should bloom for up to 3 months. They're really a great orchid. Some people just treat them like cut flowers, and after they finish blooming, they throw them away. But they'll repeat bloom. It's not that hard to get them to repeat bloom.
Okay.
Okay, thank you for the call.
Thank you.
So, yeah, Phalaenopsis are a wonderful orchid. They come in a myriad of colors and sizes. You can get little tiny ones to great big ones, pure whites to stripes and pinks and all sorts of colors. And now they even have blues, but the blues are actually a dye. It's not a blue flower. It's not a true blue flower, because when they repeat bloom, they won't be blue anymore. But apparently they put a blue dye on the roots and it takes it up and ends up in the flower, and you end up with a blue phalaenopsis, but it's not a true blue flower. Well, we were talking about oyster fungus or oyster mushroom, which is, and I can't believe I've forgotten the name of the oyster mushroom. It is Pleurotus austereatus is the actual name. Now, often when I find them growing in nature, I find them much bigger than the ones we see behind me. Let's take a look at number 8. This is the oyster mushroom growing on a trunk of a tree that I took this picture several years back. And you can see they can be big. And in fact, one time I was in Albuquerque, and I went up on Sandia Crest, and I found an old stump. And the whole stump was solid oyster mushrooms, and that was in the summer. It was really fabulous. These are good edible. One of the easiest ones to recognize, and really there's nothing poisonous that looks like it at all. So I would include it as a foolproof mushroom or a foolproof 4. David Arora has his foolproof 4. I think Lepista nuda is extremely easy to identify. The oyster mushroom is extremely easy to identify. And then another one that grows on wood that you're not going to find out in the woods is the shiitake mushroom. Let's take a look at number 9. And you can see them growing off of a log. Shiitakes can be grown on wood chips in these pseudo logs or on real logs. And in fact, historically in Japan, they grow them on logs, particularly oak. Probably alder. Maple would be good. I think the pines wouldn't be particularly good, but this is Lentinula idodes, the shiitake mushroom. And take a look at this number 10 here, number 10 photo, and you can again see. Now shiitake has a white gills and a white spore print, but you're not going to find these growing out in the wild. You'd be pretty lucky to find something like this growing out in the wild. They're not native to Southern California. Often you can buy shiitake or oyster growing on a bag of inoculated sawdust. And if we take a look at number 11, this is the oyster mushroom growing on a bag of sawdust. And you can order these from a variety of places. This is all, it could be sawdust or it could be straw. It could almost be paper because oyster will grow on almost anything. And there's a pink oyster as well, and that's our next picture, number 12. And let's take a look at this. These are, this is the pink oyster mushroom. So you can grow the pink or you can grow the white. And most of these don't have a real strong flavor. Shiitake has a little bit of flavor to it. And the portobellos are also a little more flavorful. Now, historically, when they grew a lot of mushrooms, in fact, it used to be you really could only get the little button mushrooms. And then people wanted a wider variety of mushrooms. So you started seeing oyster mushrooms and some of the wild ones that are sold dry. Shiitake was available, now the oyster is available, enoki is available. And so you can grow these yourselves also in your kitchen cabinet, and you can order these inoculated logs, and you just open them up and you set them there and they can fruit. Now things can go wrong. If they go bone dry, they're not going to fruit very good for you. And also there are some fungal pathogens that can grow on them. You can get some molds to grow on them, it'll ruin them. If you're interested in growing mushrooms at home and growing just for the fun of it, or I used to do this with my kids just for their science projects for elementary school, I have a little video clip showing you how to grow mushrooms on logs. So let's go to this video clip, and when you come back, we'll talk more about fungi and mushrooms.
So I'm holding two wonderful mushrooms that were grown by the Oregon Mycological Society, and we're going to be chatting today with Ed, who's going to give us a quick synopsis of what they do and how they do it. Ed, there really are some specific steps that you go through, and I see a bunch of straw here. It looks wet to me. I'm assuming that's the beginning process, is getting things prepared for the spores.
That's correct. We make up our spawn or purchase it, and then we take wheat straw and chop it fine, put it in bags of this sort, mm-hmm. and then place it in barrels of heated water and pasteurize it for 1 hour at a temperature of 165 to 185.
And that's really just to get it ready for the spores, right?
That's correct. Then we dump it out and drain and cool it, and then pack it into bags.
And that's what Lisa's doing now. Now, you're not just putting it back in the bag. She's actually mixing the spores with it as
she
goes.
She's going to put the spawn. Don't mistake spores for spawn. That is grain spawn with mycelium running on the surface of the grain.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes spores are involved. Mostly it's a cloning process that involves taking a bit of tissue from a donor mushroom and running it on a plate of agar-agar uh-huh. that's been neutrophied. Then it's put into grain and produces what we call grain spawn.
Well, now, straw is not the only way to do this. You also, I see a couple of different types of wood down here that they're working on. Tell us quickly about
those. That's right. We're using log cultivation as another mechanism. These are non-sterile practices that we can do out in the open like this without laboratory conditions. Logs and straw bags are classic for our kind of work. That's a collection of oak, alder, and maple logs. We're putting in shiitake sawdust spawn into slices along the log, and we're going to cap the ends with a sandwich of spawn to add an ingredient of
really
inoculation.
Really covering
running.
The whole log then.
We get
ends
lots
and
of
middle.
Fast running into the sapwood and fairly rapid colonization and fruiting. That's
and
correct.
What's the difference between what you're doing at the end down there?
The end, we're using a different approach. It's called spawn plugs. They are birch mm-hmm. Or similar wood plugs with either flutes or spirals on them that have been inoculated with the mushroom mycelium, and they're tapped into pre-drilled holes. We use about 27 plugs per 2-foot log like that. They take up to 16 months to fruit, but they'll give you mushrooms on oak of that nature for up to 7 years.
Mm-hmm. You know, I think a lot of people are intimidated by growing these things, but they're really not that difficult. There are some specific steps, which you guys are more than willing to share and you know, have people come in and learn this process.
Well, we encourage people to join our group, the Oregon Mycological Society, and receive this kind of instruction. We have the equipment as a group. We teach this to our members at charge only for cost of materials. Mm-hmm. These courses cost a great deal of money on the outside. If you go to a private instruction facility or somebody that's offering these courses, they're way too expensive for most of our members. So we do what we know how to do. We've learned this over the years. We follow procedures that are well documented in literature.
One of the things I really like, too, is you get a lot of your stuff from this company. It's in Corvallis?
Northwest Mycological. Yes, John Donahue is well known in the field. He's spent a lot of time overseas promoting mushroom cultivation in developing countries. He just came back from Vietnam, and he's going over again. They're working very hard to develop a good market and production facility for shiitake. Shiitake is the most popular Asian mushroom, as you're probably aware. And it's fairly simple to grow compared to others. These mushrooms, by the way, are called primary decomposers. They grow on woody substrates, meaning wood like you see logs uh-huh. and or straw. So this is the easiest medium to work with, and that's why we do it as a group.
And on the logs, these can last anywhere from 3 to 5 years, depending on the care you get.
Depending on how often you fruit them, these logs can be soaked on a regular basis up to 5 times per year. We recommend less because that lengthens the extent of log. I do mine 3 times a year,
wow.
in spring, late summer, and early fall. My alder logs last about 3 to 4 years, oak logs 5 to 7. And you'll get 5 pounds of mushrooms off a log in its lifetime. It's a
wow.
lot of fun.
And being a lover of mushrooms, that's very exciting for me. You know, there's a lot of information here, certainly not anything that we can cover in 4 minutes, but if you want to find out more information, we invite you to go to Garden Time. And then, of course, then you would have to go to Garden Time and talk to Ed here to figure out what this is about, because it's not just scary. There is a purpose for it. Ed, this is really fascinating. Thank you so much for your time. And, you know, I look forward
okay,
to starting my own mushroom field now.
So that shows you how really simple it is to grow some mushrooms in your own garden. If you have a source of logs, you want to let your logs sit for about 2 to 4 weeks after they've been cut off the tree or the tree's been cut down, however you got your logs. Then you can order the little dowels that are inoculated with the various, you can order all sorts of different species. You can order shiitake, oyster, there's one called lion's mane, there's some others. And then you drill the log and you pound in the oak pegs and you seal that with a little wax, and then you put that where it'll get rained on, or if you have a lawn, on the edge of the lawn where the sprinklers will water it about once or twice a week, maybe 3 times a week in the summer. and then it'll grow all through the log. Now, that doesn't guarantee you're going to be successful. I did a bunch of logs about a year ago, and I did them in shiitake and lion's mane, which is hirsium. It's a tooth fungus. And one of those logs is fruiting like crazy right now, but it's not fruiting anything I put in it. It's fruiting turkey tail, which is, I can't remember the genus. I'll have to look it up. But anyway, we have a lot of natural fungi or native fungi that often decompose logs, and we're competing with them a little bit. So I don't know exactly what went wrong. A different fungus got a hold of the log, and I'm not going to get any mushrooms off of it. But it really is fruiting like crazy, but it's growing turkey tail instead of lion's mane or shiitake. Unless they sent me the wrong dowels, but I don't think so. I'm sure they sent me the right dowels. Let's take a look at a couple other things. Now, so we've looked at guild mushrooms and a couple of different kinds of guild mushrooms. The Amanitas and stuff like that. There's all sorts of guild mushrooms. There's just hundreds of them. And they're all exciting and fun. But there's also what we call the poroid fungi, or particularly the boletes. Let's take a look at number 13. And the boletes, many of the boletes are excellent edibles. I'll bring this up full screen. This is Boletus phleboporus. And now if you look at this surface here, this is the hymenial surface, or the pore-forming surface. And these are pores. They're little tiny pores. It's hard to see that these are little holes, and the spores are made down in the holes. And now, if we take a look at the next one, is also another Boletus, Boletus dryophilus. And maybe we'll get a better look at the pores. The pores can be really tiny or quite large. Now, the pores here are quite a bit larger. If you look here, you can see that this is a little more larger pores. The other thing you notice right in here, it's stained blue. And right in here, when you handle it, it's staining blue. That can be a very important characteristic, is when you're handling it, it stains blue. There's a lot of fungi or mushrooms that actually do that. And of course, here the cap is red, and you got these cracks in it, which are important. So this is a Boletus dryophilus. I've actually collected this quite a few times under oaks at various places throughout Southern California. And some of the more popular edibles, Boletus edulis, or the king bolete, is by far one of the most sought after wild mushrooms. And really, really fabulous, very firm, really wonderful flavor. And so people are looking for that. There are some boletes that'll make you sick to your stomach. I don't think any of them will kill you. None of them are like Amanitas that kill you. There's a whole lot of little tiny guild mushrooms that'll come up in your lawn, particularly in the summer months. And many of those are so small and frail that they're not worth trying to eat anyway. But some of them are pretty good poisonous mushrooms. So you got to be real careful about picking wild mushrooms if you don't know what you're doing. Now, the clip we saw was from the Oregon Mycological Society, and we also have the Los Angeles Mycological Society, LAMS, and they meet monthly at the Natural History Museum. And every February, they have a mushroom fair at the Arboretum, and the mushroom fair is fabulous. And it's be coming up. I don't have the date right at my fingertips, but I'll get you that date. And on Saturday, they go out, all the members of the club go out and they go to various locations and they collect mushrooms. We were having some good rain this year, or a little bit of rain at least. So we have a good shot at having some mushrooms, a lot of mushrooms coming up. They'll go up into the Santa Monica Mountains, they'll go up on Azusa Highway, they'll go down to the Ortega Highway in the Cleveland National Forest, and they'll collect a bunch of mushrooms that they find out in the woods. They bring them all back to the Arboretum on Saturday night, and they put them out on tables, and they display them all, and they put out all the names. And if we have a good wet year, you can go there and probably see 100 different species of mushrooms. So it's really great fun, and you can see the real diversity of fungi that do grow in Southern California. If we have a dry year, you might not see so many species. They often have lectures from various authors talking about all these different issues about mushrooms, how to collect them, how to identify them, how to cook them. And I see here that the Wild Mushroom Fair will be on Sunday, February 10th. It is definitely at the Arboretum. It's always at the Arboretum. And I don't think they're moving it. Every once in a while they move these things around, but it's at the Arboretum. It's in Friends Hall. I can't think of a better place to hold it because Friends Hall is really perfect for this kind of a display. And often they'll have a demonstration on how to grow oyster mushrooms in straw. And at the end of the lecture, you go up and they stuff a bag full of straw and they sprinkle in the spawn and you tie a knot in it and poke some holes with a fork. You take it home, you put it in a dark closet or a cabinet for a few days while that mycelium grows all over the straw. The whole bag will turn white. And then you take it out and expose it to the light and it will start to fruit. It'll start putting initials out through the holes, and then you'll grow these big oyster mushrooms. It's great fun, and I've found, from my own experience, that my kids got a big kick out of watching the mushrooms grow. Now, there are some other types of fungal reproductive structures that are, you might call it a mushroom, but we don't normally call them mushrooms. We call them conchs or shelf fungi, and the artist conch is fairly common, or Ganoderma. And this is why they call it the artist conch. Let's bring this up full screen. This is the poroid surface. These have pores instead of gills, like the boleates did, but the boleates are still mushrooms because they're soft and they decompose rapidly. They only are in the environment for a week or so, and then they turn into mush and insects eat them or whatever happens to them. But these are the conchs, or the shelf fungi, are woody and hard. And the artist conch, or Ganoderma applanatum is the Latin name. This, if you scratch the white surface here, this whole white surface, if you scratch it, it stains brown, and then if you let it dry, it's permanent. So what someone's done here is broken this conch off the tree and then drawn a landscape on the surface of the pores. And normally you find this growing on the tree. Let's take a look at 16. This is how you find them. Let's go to 16 if we can. This is Ganoderma lucidum. And if we can go to 16 and show Ganoderma applanatum, here it is. Now this is a perennial conch in that every year it gets a little bigger. The first year it was this big. The next year it was this big. And the next year it was this big. And here's the poroid surface, or the hymeneal surface. Here are the pores. The spores are made here and they flow out and float off into the air. And if they land in the right spot, they germinate and start a new infection. Now, Ganoderma causes a heart rot in trees. It hollows out trees. And depending on the extent of decay in the middle of the tree, you may have to cut the tree down because it will be structurally unstable. But it doesn't normally kill trees. It's not like our malaria, the first fungus we looked at, which causes a heart rot, kills the roots, comes up under the bark, kills the vascular cambium, which is the growth layer under the bark, which is critical to the health of a tree. Ganoderma rots out the middle of the tree, and so there's a whole bunch of other conchs that Ganoderma is not the only one. There's Phalaenus and many, many others. But what they do is they get in on a wound, like a pruning wound, and then they get into the middle of the tree and they rot out the middle of the tree. But there'll be a big thick section of healthy wood that's not infested or infected. And if that's thick enough, then the tree is strong enough to hold itself up. That's very difficult to tell how thick that layer is and to determine if a tree is safe. So this is one of the things, if you see on a tree, if you see a conch fungus growing on a tree, it's cause for concern because it could be that the tree is physically or structurally not sound enough to hold itself up. You got to be careful with that. It's very common. I see conchs on oaks and eucalyptus and carobs and lots of different kinds of trees. And Ganoderma is one of the more common ones you see around Southern California, Ganoderma applanatum. Now, often if you read about it, they may talk about the Ganoderma applanatum group because maybe the ones you find up in Santa Barbara is a little different than the one you might find down in Cleveland National Forest. Is it different species? Should it all be Ganoderma applanatum? Well, we'll let the taxonomist argue that. If you lined up all the taxonomists in the world, all the mycological taxonomists in the world, they would still not come to a conclusion. Now, another Ganoderma is Ganoderma lucidum, which we just saw. Let's take a look at that. This is used in Chinese herbal medicine to make tea. And many of the Ganodermas also look like this. Bring this up full screen, in that they are shiny and they look like they've been lacquered. You see how shiny the surface is? Now, this typically has a big stem. This, you can't see it, but the stem is underneath there. This actually has a stem and doesn't grow sessile right on the wood. It can, but it often has a stem. And this part here can be ground up into a powder and made into a tea. I'm not a big believer in some of these Chinese herbal medicines, but many people are. And you can actually get this also as an inoculum or and grow it on wood. It's a wood decomposer, a primary decomposer that grows on wood. And so that's Ganoderma lucidum. And they're extremely, if you get a really good looking one that's really shiny, they're very, very valuable. They can be sold for quite a bit of money. Not so much here, but more in Japan. Now, another one that you'll see growing on trees or on causing a heart rot is sulfur shelf. And sulfur shelf, let's take a look at that. When it first comes out, it's bright yellow. It's Latiparus sulfurus. Now, I just recently saw that they want to call the one that grows on the West Coast Latiparus gilbertsonii. And again, taxonomists can disagree or agree on what we want to call these. The common name is sulfur shelf or chicken of the woods. When it comes out like this, it's soft and really full of water. You can just squeeze it and the water will come out. And it's edible in this form. But then it expands. Let's take a look at number 19. And it becomes very woody. And it's poroid. There's pores. You can't see the pores, but the pores are underneath here, all over. And it becomes very hard and dry. It's no longer edible once it gets expanded like this. Now, these are annual conchs. These come out, they grow, then they fall off the tree, and next year they start a new one. The Ganodermas are perennial conchs. And we can take a look at number 20. We'll take a look at a few of these sulfur shelf. Here's another sulfur shelf. They can be yellow or orange. They start out bright yellow, but then they'll fade to to yellow or an orange color. And here, this one's broken off, and this is the poroid surface here. And if we took a look at number 21, this is sulfur shelf growing right off of a tree, a avocado tree that ripped. You see this big rip? A branch came off and ripped. And here's last year's, or one that's older, and here are the new ones. And this is sulfur shelf. That's not oyster, because these are pores. There's pores under here. You know, when you first see this, you might, the color shouldn't fool you too much. So these are heart rot. This is causing a heart rot in this tree. You've got this big wound, it got it, infected, and now it's decaying, and the middle is gonna decay out. That's why you never wanna have a rip like this in a tree, because they never heal and they're just open to decay. So let's see if we have our next one, number 22, Claveria. These are called coral fungi, and the coral fungi are also part of what we call the basidiomycetes. Everything we've looked at so far have been what we call basidiomycetes, which are the club fungi. And in a minute, we'll look at the other major group of large fleshy fungi, which are called the sac fungi or the ascomycetes. So, we're talking about the higher fungi. The fungi can be broken up into two groups, the lower fungi, and then there's the lower fungi and the higher fungi. Sorry if I'm briefly stopping. I'm getting some messages on the screen here. If you're looking for fungi and you see large things, you're looking really at the higher fungi, and the higher fungi are broken into two groups. The sac fungi and the club fungi. The sac fungi are the ascomycetes. They make their spores inside of a sac and then they're shot in the air. The club fungi make their spores on the end of a little club in the air and then they pop off and float off in the air. And everything we've looked at so far has been club fungi. The mushrooms, the boletes, the conchs, and now we're going to look at these coral fungi. And this one here is Claveria vermicularis. And the coral fungi can be quite spectacular with a variety of colors. If we look at the next one, this is Romeria, number 23. And Romeria, this can cover the forest floor. The spores are all made on the tips here. They're real fun to find. A lot of these are edible, but some of them are so woody that they're really not particularly edible. So those are the coral fungi. Then there are many, many different species and genera of coral fungi. There are also what we call the tooth fungi. Let's take a look at one of the tooth fungi, number 24, Hirsium. So this is the lion's mane, and you can actually order this. This is an excellent edible. And here you see all these teeth, and this can be about the size of a soccer ball. I found it growing off of oak stumps up in Eaton Canyon, the size of a big loaf of bread or a soccer ball. And it's an excellent edible, and you're not going to mistake this for anything else. And you can grow this on logs, or you can grow it on sawdust, compressed sawdust logs, or even on straw. And you can get the inoculum or the materials to inoculate your straw from the internet company Fungi Perfecti. You can order it from them. There's there's a whole bunch of different types of tooth fungi. This is just one example. Another one is called Aeroscalpium vulgare. Let's take a look at that. That's number 25. And what we're looking at there is is one of the stinkhorns. This is it. Bring this up full screen so you can get a good look. This grows almost exclusively, really, on pine cones. And here's the pine cone down here. And you see all these teeth? See all the teeth right in here? This is a tooth fungus. And this whole thing is only about an inch or two long. They're real fun to find. They're very woody. They're not edible. But if you find them growing on a pine cone and with the teeth, then you're looking at Aeroscalpium, which is real fun. So the teeth fungi are another group of basidiomycetes or club fungus. There's another group of fungi that are fairly common, and a lot of people see them all the time, are the stinkhorns. Let's take a look at 26. This one is fairly common. It's called Phallus hadrianae, and they start off as an egg. Bring this up full screen. And here's the egg. Let me clear this. Here's the egg. And this is how the ammonitis start, too. They start as an egg, and then the mushroom or the reproductive structure pushes up through. In this case, when it pushes up through, you get this. And this is the spore mass here, or the gleba. And you see this reticulate area? There's this green, gooey spore mass that fills all these little holes in here. And it stinks, and it attracts flies. These typically grow and decompose woody materials. They can grow right on wood. If you dig down here, and you'll often find old dead roots or something that it's growing on. And there's Phallus hadrianae and Phallicus impudicus. There's two different species. One of them has a little color and one of them doesn't. You know, for the most part, if you recognize it as being a stinkhorn, people see these and think they're organisms from some other planet or some alien species, but they're not. They're fairly common. They often occur with dozens in an area. You'll find all these eggs and a bunch of them popped up. And then if you take a whiff of them, they often, they stink, so they attract flies. You see flies all over the place on them. There's another one that comes up called the Chinese lantern stinkhorn, and this is Lycerus moccasin. Let's take a look at this, number 27. And bring this up full screen. Now, this one's a little different. It's another stinkhorn, but the spore mass is in here in these grooves, and this often is attached here, and it'll do this, like this. And it'll be like a lantern. But you notice here, what's that? That's a fly right there. That's a fly coming down to land here because it's attracted to this because it stinks. And of course, this has kind of a fluted or ribbed stem that's pink. And these typically come up. You'll get clusters of them coming up in the summer, maybe 5, 10, to even 20 of them will come up in an area that used to have an old stump. Now, the tips don't always stay together. Sometimes they'll look like this. Let's look at 28. And you can see this one. Here's the fly. The flies are on it, but the tips have separated. So it's not going to look like the lantern. And here's another fly. So you can see, and this is in a lawn. They often come up in a lawn where there's been an old stump or some kind of woody material that's buried in the ground. Now, in addition to the stinkhorns, the stinkhorns are a part of a group we call the gut fungi, or the gastromycetes. And if you take a look at number 29, this is a puffball, and the puffballs are closely related to the stinkhorns. They're part of the gastromycetes. And there's a lot of different kinds of puffballs. This is Scleroderma sepa. And here is what we call the spore mass, or the gleba. On the stinkhorns, the gleba was at the tip of the structure. And Scleroderma is very hard. So if you find one of these puffballs, and these are very common, you find them in most gardens at some point of the year, usually in the spring or the summer. And this is very hard. That's why they call it scleroderma. Some of them will open up a pore, and if you tap them, they shoot out spores. And so they're called puffballs. And there's a lot of different kinds of puffballs. And so this is scleroderma. There is a huge one, and let's take a look at that. There's Calvatia pachyderma, which this can be the size of a basketball, and it's edible. And if you get it and you cut it open and it's white inside, then it's, you can make almost like steaks out of them. And so this is a giant puffball. And you can't tell by the scale here, but this is about the size of a soccer ball. Now, in addition to those kinds of puffballs, there's also what we call the earth stars. And let's take a look at our next picture, which is Geostrum. And this is actually a puffball, but the outer covering, which they you know, this is called the peridium. When it rains, it peels back like this, and it pushes it up into the air. And you can see this, it's like standing on these little legs. And they're called earth stars. And here's the hole, or the opening, that allows the spores to come out. If you tap this, the spores come shooting out. They're called osteoles. And so these are called earth stars. And they're not that uncommon. If you go for a walk in the woods, you might find these sitting on the ground as you walk around. They can actually persist for several years after they form, because this is actually pretty woody. This material here is pretty woody. When it dries up, these are going to come back up and cover it back up. So in addition to that, there's also, so you've got, we keep going through all these different groups. We talked about the guild mushrooms, the boletes, the conchs. Then we looked at some of the coral fungi, the tooth fungi, the stinkhorns, and the puffballs. And then there's another one, and they're called bird nest fungi. Let's take a look at number 32, and these are bird nest fungi, Crucibulum livae. Bring this up, and it looks like a little nest full of eggs. Here are these little eggs. What those really are little bundles of spores. This thing right here is filled with spores. When a raindrop comes in and hits it, it knocks it out, and this flies off and lands, and then the spores get broken up, and then they grow on the wood and make more colonies and make more bird nest fungi. And so this is Crucibulum. And the other species that I have to show you is Nidula candida. And you can find these, and sometimes you find them by the thousands, actually, all over the forest floor, or on an old fence or an old log. They'll be all over the place. And they're really fun to find. They're not edible, but they're really cool to find. And this is Nidula. Now, the other fungus that everyone wants to find when they go hunting and looking for edible mushrooms are the chanterelles. And they're not that easy to find. I don't know why I have such a hard time finding chanterelles, but they're in their own family, the Chanterellaceae. And here's the Chanterella siberius, which is the chanterelle everyone's looking for. And you can see the gills aren't so gill-like. They're just kind of folds. See in here these? They're just kind of folds. They're often bright yellow. They're not that hard to ID. They don't look anything like an ammonita or something that's going to get you sick. There's no ring. There's no vulva. And they grow in the forest floor. I've only collected them a few times over the many years. So that's the chanterelles. And that's what you can get dried chanterelles. And in fact, I think I have some dried chanterelles right here. Yes, these are dried chanterelles right here that I bought at Vaughn's, of all places. And I don't think I've ever opened it. But anyway, go to the overhead if you want to take a look at that. Now, those are really old, and I probably would never cook with them. I bought them just to use them on the show. So dried chanterelles. But the problem is you can't culture these, and so you can't mass produce them. No one's figured out how to culture them and produce them the way we produce the little white button mushrooms, or the portobellos, or the shiitakes, or the oysters, all these different types of mushrooms that are fairly easy to grow because they're just saprophytes. Chanterelles are much harder to grow, and no one's really figured out how to grow them. Now, I don't have pictures of it, but I have them here, and so I'll show you this. Let's go to the, there's another group of fungi called the jelly fungi. And there's a bunch of different kinds of jelly fungi. And when it's dry out, they shrivel up and they get dry and you can't see them. So here is a wood ear. And you see that? It's all dry. And I got this also at Vaughn's. And these are all dried and these are perfectly fine. I can cook with these anytime I want. What you do is you put them in a little water. If you put them in a sauce or a soup and you let them sit in there for just a few minutes, they suck up all the water and they become really rubbery and gelatinous. Look at this. See that? And they've only been sitting in this water a few minutes, maybe 15, 20 minutes. Or maybe I put them at the beginning of the show. Maybe it's been a little over an hour. But you see how rubbery and gelatinous they become? They don't have a lot of flavor. You know, I went to a restaurant in Pasadena called Kuala Lumpur. It's an Indonesian restaurant. And they use these wood ears all the time in their dishes. I love them. I think they're fabulous. But they're not particularly, you know, they don't have a real particular flavor. And I've collected them growing off wood. They grow right off of wood. And so that's why they're called wood ear. And it's a saprophyte. It's not a pathogen. It grows off, you know, dead, dry wood. But they're wonderful to eat. And they're, they'll taste like anything like you put them in. So, you know, if you salt them, they taste like salt. If you put them in olive oil and garlic, they'll taste like olive oil and garlic. And that's a little bit true of most mushrooms. Now, everything I showed you so far are what we call the club fungi. And the club fungi produce their spores on the end of a club. A microscopic club, a little tiny peg, really. And they've got usually four spores stuck on there, and they shoot off in the air, and they float off. The other group of fleshy fungi are called the ascomycetes, or the sac fungi. And many of the ascomycetes make very, very small reproductive structures, like little tiny black dots. The powdery mildews are ascomycetes. So if you ever see powdery mildew on roses, or on crepe myrtle trees, or on nandina, you know, heavenly bamboo, those are sac fungi, and occasionally they'll actually go ahead and make their little tiny pinhead-sized reproductive structures. And if you pluck that off, that little tiny black spot, and put on a slide and crush it and look at it, you'll see these spores inside in these sacs. But some of them are actually large and fleshy, and let's take a look at those. And some of them are prized edibles. And so number 35 is Pazyza rapanda. Now Pazyza rapanda, bring this up full screen, is very common wherever you put down a lot of woody mulch and I see it all the time at the arboretum. And if you tap this, it will shoot spores out. It's very brittle. I'd imagine this is even edible, but I don't know of anyone who bothers to eat it. So this is one of the sac fungi, but it makes what we call a cup. So it's a cup fungus within the sac fungi, the ascomycetes. And another one that I see quite frequently is the orange peel mushroom, and that's number 36. This is Alluria arantia, and I've found these growing at the Huntington. I found them growing along California, right next to Caltech. And if you tap them, they should shoot spores out, because in this lining they have these sacs and spores in the sacs. And if you tap them, the tip comes off and the spores blow out. So it's a little brittle. Now the prized edible that everyone wants to get are the morels. And the morels are sac fungi within the ascomycetes. Let's take a look at number 37. This is Morchella esculante. And there are also black morels, the different species. These you find in the spring. What this is a stem, of course, with a whole bunch of little cups all united together. And these are a prized edible. You can get them dried. No one's figured out how to really get them to grow easily for commercial production, but that's it. Now, there are some false morels, and I'll show you that. That's our last picture, number 38, Helvella lacunosa. And this is called an elfin saddle or a false morel. And they kind of, you know, this is also kind of a cup, although it doesn't really make a cup like this. But if you tap it, it will puff spores. And they're called false morels, and they're poisonous, so you got to be careful with those. So that's kind of an introduction to fungi. You can't learn everything about fungi in an hour and a half. But I've kind of given you an idea of the fungal kingdom, the role it plays in your garden. either as a saprophyte, as a pathogen, or as a beneficial growing on the roots of your trees and shrubs and all your other plants. But then there's also the fun part, going down and going mushroom hunting. And it's like going on an Easter egg hunt. Now, no one called up to guess what these are. These are called pumelos or pumelos. This is a species of citrus. It is the parent to the grapefruit. The grapefruit is a cross between pumelos and, I wonder what the other host was, parent was. I have to go back and look it up. But oranges. It's a cross between an orange and a pumelo. The grapefruit are cross between an orange and a pumelo, and you got grapefruits. They're a little sour, quite a bit more sour than a grapefruit. They have an extremely thick rind. And here's the thing about fruit. And if you haven't talked about marketing fruit or heard anyone talk about marketing fruit, is there's a lot of fruit for sale in the supermarket. And if when you try and introduce a new fruit, you're competing with all the other established fruits. And certain fruit is extremely popular and hard to compete with. And fruits that are easy to peel with no seeds are the most popular. Well, what is that? That's bananas. Apples are extremely popular. Oranges are extremely popular. So to get stores to carry something like this is nearly impossible unless you are really appealing or marketing to a certain ethnic group. And these are very popular in the Asian community. But the only way to get them really, for the most part, is to grow one of these in your yard. Now, so that's pumelo, and I would cut it in half, but I didn't bring a knife with me. But the rind is about 2 inches thick, and then the flesh is pretty sour, in my opinion. Maybe I'm picking them a little early. Now, next week, we're going to be back again, and we're going to talk about insects. Insects are one of the major groups of plant pests. I think everyone would recognize that. Some of them are easy to control with things like oils and soaps. Others are much more difficult to control. If you don't control insects on your plants, they can do a lot of damage, especially in addition to the insects, there are the arachnids, which are pretty much the mites. Now, arachnids are spiders, ticks, and mites. They have 8 legs. Insects have 6 legs. But mites can be a big problem, too. So we'll look at how to control mites. We'll look at all the different groups of insects. And that'll be our show next week. And then the week after that, we're going to look at integrated pest management. Now, you have to understand the insects a little bit in order to understand what types of products to use to control them. So until then, I want to thank our crew for all their hard work in bringing the show to you today, and thank all our viewers and our caller today. And I want to wish you happy gardening until I see you next week.